All right, officially good afternoon. Thank you for the warm welcome. I am so excited about the panel that we have today that I'm going to introduce you to in just a second here. The topic is, how are the most disruptive companies in the world adopting an automation-first mind frame to stay on top of their industries? So we've assembled Amazon, Uber, and SiriusXM Pandora to tell us what they're doing with automation and how automation is helping them stay on top. So without further ado, I'd like to bring our panelists up. We're gonna go sit there and we're gonna start talking. Panelists.
Thank you.
All right.
Adrian.
All righty, so let's get started. First off, I'd like to introduce our panel. Let me get some notes out here. We have Delphine Bernard from Uber. She is the global head of finance ops. She leads procurement, supply chain, A&R, T&E, payroll, finance, shared services, and the RPA COE. Delphine does a lot at Uber. She serves 40,000 suppliers, 20,000 employees in 70 countries. Before Uber, she was at Microsoft and Skype as the group controller. Delphine, thank you for being here today.
Thank you. Welcome.
Next up, we have Jonathan Finch. Jonathan is the assistant treasurer and CIO for automation for Amazon Cash Management. He runs capital markets, workers' comp, and insurance at Amazon. He is chartered with automating and transforming systems and processes. He was previously at JP Morgan Chase, where he managed a tech infrastructure for US and EMEA. Jonathan, thank you for being here today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Okay. And next we have Abe Khalili. Abe is the head of PMO and the intelligent automation practice at SiriusXM Pandora. Abe is the executive responsible for delivering future state technology spanning RPA, cloud, SaaS, and AI to drive growth and scalability across enterprise systems at SiriusXM and Pandora. Abe has extensive experience working with enterprise applications, back office systems, and processes over a long career at companies like Nestle, Electronic Arts, and now Pandora SiriusXM. Abe, thank you for being here as well.
Glad to be here.
All right, so let's jump in. We're going to start by asking our panelists a little bit about their company's automation journey. So, Delphine, I'll start with you. Can you tell us about how it got started at Uber and where you guys are going?
Yeah, so it all started on April 1st, 2018. I woke up and I said, I will start RPA. And there it was, we started. I wish, April Fool. Transformation is a journey. It's a journey that we not just look from the RPA angle, but the whole like end-to-end spectrum. And with that, we started our journey back in 2017, where we start transforming all the finance function, implementing new solution. At the same time, we wanted to look beyond that and not just like implementing system. I knew something else was missing. And then early on 2018, we started involving with the RPA function. And what's important here is to think like, I don't need to wait to be at the end of my order automation to start bringing on like that connection that we got through the RPA. So officially, we started around April 2018, truly. But it was a journey to get through and really start implementing our POC, developing more and more bots. And now we are fully live with a good 50 automation.
Great. Sounds like a typical journey for most of the customers I speak to. Jonathan, what about at Amazon? How did it start for you guys?
So automation's in the DNA of Amazon, obviously, from Alexa to the robots and the fulfillment centers. But RPA is actually new to us. I mean, I think Amazon's all in on automation. We have been for years. We just had a $700 million announcement in upskilling a lot of our workers on machine learning, software development, RPA. I think there's a bit of a mental model shift that we're going through at Amazon around RPA. You know, historically, if you had something that was manual and repetitive, you would move that to an offshore center. I think RPA is going to disrupt a lot of that. And so the mental model shift for us is, how do we create a digital workforce and move these processes to a digital workforce versus a human workforce in a lower cost geography? So that's one of the big things we're going through right now.
Awesome. Thank you. And Abe, at SiriusXM Pandora, what's your journey like?
Yeah, we started late 2017, and the whole journey started with the organizational directive for operational efficiency. So that was the driver for where RPA started. There was a lot of conversation in the marketplace as well as amongst peers at the executive level about AI, about RPA, and that's when we started looking at this as a program. We got some validation from some of our partners that we partner with in terms of this technology. We started off with a pilot because we wanted to make sure that this thing is real. We wanted to touch, feel, and experience it. And our journey for a good part of 2018 has been a pilot that we implemented across our finance business unit as well as our ad operations unit. Legacy Pandora, which is now part of SiriusXM, drives its revenue mostly from advertising, right? And so we did a pilot in that space, and a vindication of that, and we've moved on to bigger things in 2019. We've moved across multiple business units with a whole bunch of processes that are being automated. We're reaching a point of where there is sufficient executive buy-in, right, as well as a belief that this thing is real, it can deliver. We have a voice of customer, that is our internal customers, the business units that are supporting us in our journey for scale.
Awesome, Abe. I want to hear a little bit more about how you got executive buy-in, but we'll get to that in a couple of minutes, because sure. I think that's an important component of scaling RPA. So, as I hopefully you guys had fun at the celebration last night before the conference started. For those of you who were here, as I was talking to folks, many people came up to me and told me they were really excited about this panel because they wanted to hear how some of the most impressive in companies in the world, companies that have really changed our lives, look at things like automation. And how are you guys using it to adapt and stay on top and maintain your competitiveness in your markets? So first off, Jonathan, let's start with you. Amazon is renowned for what they have done to make the customer experience better on the front office and the front end of the business.
Yep.
But how are you using automation to make the back office more efficient?
So from Brian Olsavsky down, CFO of Amazon, every meeting we have, he asks, what are you doing to automate the business? So if I push pause right now on Amazon, mm-hmm. and I just look at finance, so the org I sit in, we have about 10,000 employees. I'd say 10 to 15% are all in a tech job family. So we have software engineers, we have data scientists, machine learning, we're starting to hire RPA developers. But the complexity that we manage, we have no choice but to automate it. So historically, Amazon, in a lot of tech companies, finance needs to maintain controllership, ensure integrity of the financial statement, and then, almost as importantly, just don't slow down the business. So if I think about Amazon today and the footprint, it blows my mind. I mean, we have, hundreds of legal entities, thousands of bank accounts, 100 subsidiaries, every line of business you can think of. I mean, it hurts to think about it. The way we've compensated and supported that growth historically is to hire operational headcount. So as the business is growing, we're adding heads. Well, we can't do that. That's not a long-term sustainable strategy. And so we are all in 100% on automation. And so, it's whether it's building new platforms and tools, hiring software development engineers or RPA. And so, some examples would be like intercompany. I mean, the amount of intercompany transactions we have are in the millions per month. We need to automate all of that. Tax withholding. Cash positioning is something that we're thinking about RPA for. A lot of treasury departments are doing that. So 100% all in.
Awesome.
Yeah. I would say on that, I think it's, that operational mindset is very important. But I think one other part that I think it's very important, what we have at Uber as one of our values, like what we call customer love, customer obsess. And if you think of everything we're doing for the front end customer, what about internal customers? We all, the majority of us here, have internal customers. And what is it for them that when they need their numbers, when they need to have an invoice paid, their expense, their payroll, it takes so long, or the app is not sexy, the system is not funny, or people are not responding to you on time or in your languages or whatsoever. So we do so much for the front end and not that much for the back end. And for me, when we talk about customer obsessed and the way Dara, our CEO, does, is that it really transcends across the entire company. And we're all trying to do better for our customers. So we think of that way. I really want the same way you take your phone, you click a button, you get a ride. you take your phone, you click a button, you get your financial. Because the point of the whole automation is like how we help the business to be able to be faster at taking the decision and taking the right decision. So that's really where we go, the mindset of disrupting the area.
Yeah, and I love that approach because I think by taking the values of the company and attaching, and in a justified way, what automation can do to the values of the company, it's probably a lot easier to get buy-in from executives that are that need to approve your budgets to do this, right? So, Abe, we've talked a little bit about getting buy-in. Can you talk about how you've done that at SiriusXM Pandora?
So the program did start with, I would not say an executive mandate, but an executive interest in this area, right? It wasn't so much about a mandate. Pandora is, it's the disruptor in the music listening space, right? So that DNA runs within our organization. So we got together, and I think the approach that we took was, I tend to call it the, and we've spoken about this, Diego, is the bottoms-up approach. People wanted to know if this thing really works, right? That's a big question. I think, you know, for a lot of people in the room today, right, that are new to RPA or just starting on their journey, I think people want to know. This is exactly where we were in, early 2018. So the way we went about it was to build something. We built something with the blessings of business. They identified some processes that could be automated. We went ahead, built it. We showed them the benefits. They were able to see the success. That's actually kind of touch and feel. We had aha moments. I mean, it's amazing. It's really, truly amazing. And for many of you that have probably done this the first time, the first demo comes up, and you see that thing run, not from this stage, but in your organizations.
Yeah.
And you have, like, you know, people going like, wow, right? And we got that wow moment from the business. We carried that through, a set of roadshows and a set of reinforcement methods. To help build the business case and the business model for RPA. So for the most part, at least until some time ago, a lot of our journey has been bottoms up. It's reached an inflection point where this thing is, there is belief in RPA, it is true, we know it is, it's delivering for us, and we're starting to see a lot of executive buy-in. We're hoping to have a big 20.
Awesome, yeah, I think one of the things I heard you talk, I mean, if I could sum it in a phrase, get some quick wins, right?
That's
you know, show it out there successfully. Absolutely. Delphine, did you guys have any quick wins that you were able to show?
We had, an interesting story because we didn't get a mandate to start with. We also have a mentality of a company that everybody can try something new. We have a lot of incubator system, but often coming from tech, and often we have a lot of people building their own program and their own bots. So coming from finance, people were looking a bit at us as like, what the hell are you doing here? You're in finance, don't touch my world, don't do, you know, technical stuff. So our request to make it work, we had to take one of the hardest process to prove that it could work. So which was bringing some challenges overall, but we were successful on bringing those challenges. And at the end, yes, we had a mix of like quick wins and everything, but I think the true lesson learned that I had from there is like, know your stakeholders, because your win will be very different for each of the different stakeholders. And some of them, you need to get the buy-in early on. Some of them will be risk averse and therefore don't want to see any change. It's like, oh yeah, it's good that you do some process improvement, automation, but not for me, I'm not ready. Some others will be overexcited and in fact like keep on giving you stuff that is not a good case, not a good candidate. So really balance and like understanding who you're talking to and like adapt your message, because I think we try at some point to have too many roadshow like the same way, and that didn't work. So adapting is very important.
That makes a lot of sense. So show some quick wins and adapt those quick wins to the audience that you're showing it to.
Absolutely.
Great. One of the things that comes up frequently as companies get started on RPA is the fear of automation, right? And will a robot take my job? I think we're starting to see the tide turn on that a lot, and especially in some of these companies that are progressing very rapidly. In fact, starting to help drive higher employee satisfaction. So Jonathan, can you share any examples of how you were able to do this at Amazon?
Yeah, a couple. So we hired a kid, I say kid because I'm dating myself, out of Stanford about 18 months ago, and he's on our FX trading desk. So the UiPath team that works with us knows Sam really well. Sam is on our trading desk. He's a FX trader. Every time you do a trade, you go through segregation of duties, and you've got to get certain approvals. That process is very manual. It takes about eight hours a week of Sam's time. So Sam did not go to Stanford and then come to Amazon to spend 8 hours a week doing copy-pasting. And you know, I'd also say that the college graduates today are much more technically inclined than I was when I came out of college. Matter of fact, you know, I've got four kids. One of my daughters in fourth grade, we're having dinner. She goes, "Dad, I'm smarter in fourth grade than when you were in fourth grade." And I said, "Well, this is going to be an interesting conversation. So why don't you tell me more why you think you're smarter than I was when I was in fourth grade? I want some popcorn for this, you know." And she says, "Well, because I'm learning how to code and I have a Google Chromebook."
That's true.
And I just, you know, I like that blew my mind. And I think that, you know, the college, I mean, the younger generation who are coming into the workforce love this stuff. And so in Sam's use case, we had the UiPath people here. He downloaded the community edition. He automated his own process in about 4 hours. And his employee satisfaction went through the roof. So that's just one of many examples. So.
Yeah, we've actually seen some of our customers start putting in their job postings. You get to work with robots, right? Because yeah, people coming out of school don't want to do the mundane stuff. Abe, are there any other misperceptions?
Yeah, just to build on what he said, right? I don't think Stanford would be a very expensive degree to go to just come and click a button at a workplace.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. I don't think that excites anybody. So that's part of our messaging. But I have a colleague of mine in the audience, and she and I, Kim, who's in the audience, she and I do road shows within Pandora Sirius, where we evangelize RPA, right? So we are the evangelists within our company. We've had some slip-ups. You go in with a lot of passion in terms of what you believe this is. We all believe the good that this can do for companies, for our work, and how it can make us more productive and efficient. I think the messaging is important. Because people sitting in the audience can misconstrue. There's a lot of talk about robots, automation, AI. I was just, you know, saw a headline yesterday, "Get prepared for jobs in the AI age." You know, somebody reads a headline like that, it sounds, you know, it can freak you out, right? So I think the messaging is important. We have, you know, learned from our messaging. We've also had an instance where we've built a POC for a department. And the team that was on the POC goes through the 20-minute session, and one person turns to Kim and I and says, "That's my job," right? And that's a true moment. That's a true moment. This is a paradigm shift in the ways that we work. We've seen it all morning. That is a reality. The ways that we work is changing. The way we are tackling problems, to what Jonathan said, is changing. That's a reality. I think it's part of the messaging and how we take this message forward in telling people we're empowering you, we're reskilling you, retooling you, upskilling you. Right.
That's how we've
seen it.
Be visible with what you're doing.
Absolutely.
Let people see what it is so that, you know, people fear what they can't see. As soon as you open up transparency, it makes people more comfortable.
So that is very true. That's great. And just if I may add to that, I think that's where the executive buy-in is very important.
Yes.
You know, if you're a little low on the totem pole like I am, it's difficult to carry that message.
Well, you've been able to battle through it and been very successful. Okay, so, you know, as the industry is maturing, we've seen the operating model mature as well. What I'd love to hear a little bit about, and Delphine, if we could start with you, is where does the COE live, you know, the Center of Excellence live at Uber? How do you guys operationalize this? How does that work inside the company?
Yeah, so today it lives within my organization in finance. And the reason why it is within finance is because it started there. I think there's not a good or bad or wrong place to have it. It's like, where does it make sense within your organization at a point of time? And this is something that will evolve and keep on changing. And how do you help like solving those solutions? If we think that we're here to solve the customers and all internal stakeholders, the best place to make it is where we had most of the information. So owning the shared service center, we could see a lot of potential, and that's how we started. Also, by being finance corporate, we know more about the governance structure, the audits and controls that are truly also important when you launch such a program. So it started there. I will see it evolve over time, and maybe in a few years I come back and say it somewhere else.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Yeah, I think it depends a lot on the company and how the company grew up. Abe,
what
about it?
In our model, Delphine is a customer of ours, right? So we have a hybrid model, and to her point, nothing's written in stone. We're all learning, we're all growing. We call it more a center of enablement, and a robotic operations center is what is the center of it, sits in IT, right? And then we have RPA leads, RPA champions. The finance team within the integrated SiriusXM Pandora is looking at a COE at themselves. We're helping develop and deploy and support from an IT standpoint. The center of enablement is also looking at new technologies and how we stay ahead of the curve, right? And that's where we can be proactive, and this is where IT can bring business value. We're very cognizant of that. But we're today in a hybrid model, but we've been told that it may not be the case, right? Because business users definitely want to be empowered. I think, if I may say, gone are the days, and you will agree with me on this, mm-hmm. is when business users needed to raise an IT request to say, give me this. They would love to get stuff that they can access, and RPA is one of those things. But for now, it's a hybrid model, sitting in IT, supported by business.
And going back to both of you for this next question, because I'm curious how you handle this situation. So we talk about, you know, when the automation first mindset takes place, takes hold in an organization, you start to think about how do you redesign old processes or create new processes, thinking about the most efficient mix of humans and robots working together. So starting with you again, Delphine, from where it lives inside finance, how do you guys think about redesigning processes?
Yeah, and I love the speaker before, but it's really about that. It's really mm-hmm. about like your change management, and like when you think about your digital transformation, is how you play and tweak the people to embrace those changes. And I think that's the hardest piece, like how you break that code. With that, we have started like putting example where we give Six Sigma training or change mindset, because I think what is truly important is like not what we call garbage in, garbage out, right. And therefore implementing something that is bad, a bad process, or trying to go too fast and going on the speed over the quality. And helping people to think forward, like how do you transform, how do you change, what does it mean, what is like your north or where you're trying to go, and then helping driving those conversations help us to rethink how it goes. Then on your question between like people and bots, it's like the bots and any kind of automation is there to augment people, and if you view that and view them like augmenting them, it could be with them as a partner and partner in crime to both get better.
Perfect. And
yeah, the example I always give, and this is what we've learned, is like flying a plane or flying in a plane and wanting to change the engine. Yeah. Hopefully not both the engines. Yeah. That'd be crazy. But we're constantly seeing that, and that's to the earlier session, right? The unconscious mind is how I think we humans operate. We develop PDDs and, you know, design documents based on how humans think and how humans tackle work. But as we start to develop bots or RPA processes, people start to think about things differently. So to your point, we are seeing a lot of we've always gone in saying, let's not look at automating 100%, which is fine, right? I think that's a lofty goal, but we all know that. It's difficult to achieve 100% automation for all processes. So we have come to a point, and especially in our finance organization, where people have started to think about processes as, what does the bot need to do in order to take on the next step? And I think that's a great, great starting point for how the team is now starting to think about automation and RPA, right? So we have business users saying, hey, as we're doing this, how would the bot know that this is an invoice?
Right.
Say, hey, great question. Mm-hmm. Let's find out, right? So we're seeing a lot of this, processes that are being broken down into the human-bot-human interactions. And it's, yeah, I think the inflection point is that.
And what about specifically in regards to SiriusXM and Pandora and the merger?
Absolutely.
Some of the complications around that. How did automation help you with that?
Oh, absolutely. I'm not a finance person, both of you are here, yeah. But closing the books, right? You're absolutely right. Two different companies, two different business operating models, but also back office models, right? A lot of challenges. We are seeing that we are starting to leverage RPA in shared services, as well as within the core, reporting and reconciliation spaces. So RPA has come at the right time for us in two companies coming together. We're seeing a lot of work happen in the integration space.
Right. Instead of perhaps
exactly
going under with APIs and complex lengthy projects.
I'll give you an integration example, right? Human resource platform. To get onto a unified human resource platform is extremely challenging for two companies. Delphine, you and I were speaking backstage. You've been part of such acquisitions. You know that, right? And either you get to the market quickly and leave something on the table. Whatever we are leaving on the table, we are taking the help of RPA to help integrate and automate.
Perfect. All right, two more questions. Jonathan, this one's
yes.
for you. We've talked about putting RPA in the hands of the citizens, the process owners. Param today introduced Studio X, and it's targeted for citizen developers.
Yep.
Jonathan, I think this is something that Amazon is interested in. Can you expand upon that a little?
Yeah, so I mean, Amazon's all about leadership principles, and it sort of governs everything we do. All of our major decisions, we challenge each other and we debate. But if I think about the ones that stand out to me, is ownership is number one, bias for action is number two, invent and simplify is number three. And you can look these up, but all of these really tie to a citizen development model. Amazon doesn't have a CIO. We don't have a centralized IT team. We actually invent in small teams and we go quick. And so speed and bias for action. So like, I had a mentor, when I was a newly minted people manager, who said the speed of the manager is the speed of the team. And I've thought about that, over the course of my career. And when RPA came in, I thought, well, the speed of the automation is going to be the speed of how many people we can actually have out there automating. And so it's really a priority for us, and we're pushing really hard on this front.
All right. Well, speaking of today's product announcements, last question for each of you. We'll start with you, Abe. From today's announcements, what excites you most and why?
Thanks, Param, for everything. Two things. Studio X, excellent tool. Low code, no code, absolutely very helpful. And the second is the UiPath Connect, the portal for enterprises. It's going to be extremely useful to help evangelize our story.
Awesome. Jonathan.
I think what he said, plus the integration of RPA and AI, for us, I think about how I... right now, we're doing both, but they're disparate technologies. And so we actually have a use case for cash forecasting. If I could get all those together and not use different teams and different tools, that'd be awesome.
And I'm just taking from you both, because I think, thank you for the demo. I think it was really insightful to see how far we can go. And I always think of all the different applications we have and we can see it working. So really insightful.
Perfect. Okay. Well, thank you all for being here today and sharing your knowledge with everyone in the audience. With that, we are going to let you guys go off to lunch. It'll be in the Grand Ballroom, and we'll see you back here in just a bit. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.